Echo and Harper Audio present Be Mine, a Frank Bascombe novel by Richard Ford. Performed by Richard Poe. Christina. Happiness. Lately, I've begun to think more than I used to about happiness. This is not an idle consideration at any time in life, but it is a high-dollar bonus topic for me, born 1945, approaching my stipulated biblical allotment. Being an historical Presbyterian, not attending, not believing, like most Presbyterians, I've passed easily through life observing a version of happiness old Knox himself might have approved. Walking the fine line between the twinned injunctions that say, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger, and happiness is whatever is not bludgeoning unhappiness. The second being more Augustinian, though all these complex systems get you to the same mystery. Do what now? This median path has worked fairly well through most situations life has flung my way. A gradual, sometimes unnoticed succession through time without anything great happening. Though nothing unsurvivable, and most of it quite okay. The grievous death of my first son. I have one other. Divorce. Twice. I've had cancer. My parents have died. My first wife has also died. I've been shot in the chest with an AR-15 and nearly died myself, but improbably didn't. I've lived through hurricanes and what some might say was depression. It was mild if it was depression at all. Nothing, however, has sent me spiraling to the bottom, so that cashing in my own chips seemed like a good idea. Much quite good contemporary literature, which I read in bed and, if I angle the page right, is all about just such matters. With happiness ever elusive, but still the goal. And yet, I'm not sure if happiness is the most important state for us all to aspire to. There are statistics on these subjects, graduate degrees, fields of study offering grants. A think tank at UCLA. Happiness apparently declines in most adults through their 30s and 40s, bottoming out in the early 50s, then sometimes starting up again in the 70s. Though it's not a sure thing. Knowing what you fear in life may be a more useful measure and skill set. When asked by an interviewer, do you feel you could have been happier in life? The poet Larkin said, no, not without being someone else. Thus, purely on average, I would say I've been happy. Happy enough, at least, to be Frank Bascombe and not someone else. And until late days, that has been more than satisfactory for getting along. Recently, however, since my surviving son, Paul Bascombe, who's 47, became sick and presenting well-distinguished symptoms of ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, though there's speculation the Iron Horse really didn't have it but had something else, the subject of happiness has required more of my attention. For the last 18 months, I have held a part-time job at House Whisperers in Haddam, New Jersey, where I live a solitary, senior, house and library card holder's life. House Whisperers is a boutique realty entity nestled within a larger, vertically integrated realty entity owned outright by my former employee, Mike Mahoney, from my and our roaring 90s house seller days on the Jersey Shore. A certified Tibetan, he long ago changed his name from Lobsang Dargi to something more Irish. Mike got seriously rich by noticing a new market of well-financed Tibetan investors itchy to buy distressed New Jersey beach property, left behind by the latest hurricane. Getting rich almost always involves recognizing a market before the other guy. Though who knew Tibetans had that kind of liquidity, or how they came by it? From selling distressed beach holdings, Mike moved swiftly, using his newfound asset position to leveraging the purchase of hundreds of once regular family homes in Topeka, Ashtabula, Cedar Rapids, and Caruthersville, Georgia. Residences, which had become problematic for their owners due to tax liens, deferred maintenance, owner infirmity, fixed income woes, unpaid alimony, etc. These houses he fixed and still fixes up on the cheap, using outsourced construction crews, assigning their upkeep to maintenance companies he owns, then securitizes the buildings into widgets he sells as shares on the Tokyo Exchange to anybody, often other Tibetans, ready to take a risk. After which he rents them, sometimes back to their prior owners. Every bit of this shenanigan is perfectly legal following the lost decade of housing, when the banking sector went prospecting for richer seams. HSP, Mike's umbrella company, is called. Himalayan Solutions Partners. There are no partners. House Whisperers, where I nominally work, is Mike's separate vest pocket niche project, whereby he locates and services high-end homebuyer clients who, for their own reasons, desire complete BPSS-level anonymity when purchasing a home. There are plenty of people at all stages of the purchase process, right up to and past the point of sale, who simply don't want the world to know their beeswax. People who want to buy a house, then never live in it, visit it, or even go inside. People who want a house for Grandpa Beppo until he passes and the will clears probate. Or people who want to buy a house to actually live in but are famous rock stars, disgraced politicians, or Russian dissidents who don't like publicity or for a clamor to be made. House Whisperers reaches out to this market for a hefty fee. I'm not talking here about people in the witness protection program or convicted weenie waivers who can't find refuge in the general population. These cases are handled by government agencies and don't involve our type of clients. I, years ago, let my own realtor's ticket lapse, but I have been willing to come on board with Mike to jolt myself awake and out of my house in the aftermath of divorce and my second wife, Sally Caldwell, deciding to dedicate her life to one of service by counseling the grieving on distant shores, where a whole lot of grieving presumably goes on. She has recently taken orders as a lay nun, so a happy reconfiguring of our married life is likely not in sight. Our small House Whisperer's office occupies second-floor space on Haddam Square, above Hewlett's Shoes, across from the August Inn. My job there is really only a semi-job. Not the gig economy, but not exactly not. I do little more, in truth, than answer the phone and pass along private contact info to our agency higher-ups. My minimal duties, however, afford, as one of their side attractions, the chance to dispense granular, ground-level, real-time real estate intel to people who've misunderstood our internet grill, which states we are confidential consultants offering unique home-buying strategies to an uncommon clientele. Citizens who, incorrectly, believe this describes them, routinely call me up seeking the lowdown on the commonest nuts-and-bolts real estate quandaries, which I'm only too happy to help them resolve, based on years of experience. How, for instance, does a reverse mortgage really work, and at age 92, with comorbidities, should I jump into one? No. What's the downside on Chinese drywall for my mother-in-law apartment? Lawsuits await. Where's the break-even for the fixer-upper I'm about to drop on the rental market, but that needs new soffits? When was it ever not a landlord's market? Make money by spending money. Most of this information you can get out of the New York Times. Only people don't want to be bothered, which is why the rest of us have jobs. Plus, most citizens, even in high-end Haddam, don't read newspapers anyway. Mike Mahoney, my would-be boss, is, as ever, a semi-lovable, quasi-honest entrepreneurial dynamo, who believes that in all of his money-making forays, he's been natively responsive to the suffering of others, by relieving them of their encumbrances, their homes. All of it in accordance with some dharmic dictum found in a bardo somewhere. I am sympathetic to him, if only because he risks his skinny Tibetan ass on long shots and wins. And yet, On my shady block of Wilson Lane, the old ether of true residence has all but burned off now, as with many close-in neighborhoods across the land, leaving the door ajar to absentee owners, private equity snap-ups, Airbnbs, and executive apartments, where before, citizen pharmacists, teachers, librarians, and seminary profs paid the taxes and rightly took pride. It's rare anymore to know who lives next door to you. If you died in one of these not-quite domiciles, no wreaths would appear on the door, no pastor call, no neighbors would show up with a hot dish. In my day, I marketed these houses like flapjacks, but always to humans who wanted to live in them, raise children, celebrate birthdays and holidays, get divorced, and die mostly happy. Last October, as I sat at my house whisperer's desk, looking out the window onto the borough green where two young girls in gym shorts were hanging banners for Oktoberfest, something quite unusual happened to me. Entirely without knocking, across the threshold of my tiny office walked my mother, who, as far as I knew, had been dead 56 years. Not my actual mother, but her twin. If all those years hadn't intervened, and if my mother had had a twin, which she didn't. From behind my desk, I must have gaped like a drunk man. My mouth may actually have fallen open. I heeled my chair backwards in alarm, since I felt I was possibly having a stroke. "You don't look very happy to see me," my mother said, or the woman who looked like her the last time I saw her alive, 1965. This person gazed at me, mock seriously, then smiled an enigmatic smile. She was 60, near my mother's age when she died, and possessed my mother's complex, mirthful face and dense silver hair done in a pageboy, as well as her pert little features that made her seem vivacious and on to whatever foolishness you were advertising. "I'm sorry," I said, reclaiming a relieved smile. "Not many people come in without appointments. You remind me of someone I loved very much who died a long time ago." These words I blurted, as might happen in a dream. "Uh-oh, that old story," the woman said skeptically. "Well, I'm not your ex-wife, Dolores, or your second wife, if that's who I look like. My husband would get a kick out of you. I'm looking for the dentist's office, Dr. Calderon. I may have come in the wrong entry. They got the signs all screwed up by the shoe store." She opened a glittering regiment of choppers. "These are brand new implants," she said. "I'm transitioning back to a real dentist." "Okay." Calderon had been my dentist for 35 years. Should have retired a decade ago, but doesn't have anything better to do. I hadn't visited him in a while and needed a crown redo. "He's in number 12. Back down to the street and turn left. It's the next entry beyond the shoe store." I re-offered her my recovered smile, but my heart was pounding. "What happens in here?" the woman said, looking around. "What's a house whisperer? Are you a private detective?"
"No, real estate," I said.
"Oh, okay." She raveled her mouth. "Cute name. So who was it I looked so much like?"
"My mother." I didn't want to admit it. Who knows why?
"Ooh, really? That's so sweet. Does it make you happy to see her again? Me, I mean. Sometimes I see deceased people in my dreams. It always thrills me. For a while, anyway."
"Well, yes," I said. "It does." It did.
"See, you can defeat death just by dreaming. My mom's still alive, and she's a terror. Still in Manalapan. Does her own shopping. Drives her little Kia. I don't see her, but my sister does."
"That's good."
"Oh, well," my mother said. "We don't get to choose our parents, do we? They don't choose us either, so it works out."
"No, we don't. I mean, I guess it does. We probably wouldn't choose the same ones, would we?"
My mother was in my little office speaking these words to me. I might very well have lost consciousness or started baying.
I don't know, I said. Yes, you do. But I get it, the woman said. I get it. You're real busy. You have a blessed day, okay? Meanwhile, I'm at the dentist. What's your name? Frank, I said. I started to say just Bascombe. Okay, Frank. Try to remember the kind of September. With those words, one of which was my name, my mother walked out the door, closed it behind her, and was gone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.